Everyone wants to know where Bitcoin's price is headed, but what if the answer isn't in a crystal ball, but already written in its code? Let's forget the wild price targets, the frantic charts, and the talking heads on the news. All of that is just noise. The chaos you see in the daily price is a tiny part of a much bigger and surprisingly predictable story. We're going to break down how Bitcoin's fundamental economic principles, scarcity and utility, create a clear path for its long-term value. Most people look at Bitcoin and see a purely speculative gamble, a digital lottery ticket that flies up and down based on market whims. They see volatility and they see risk. And in the short term, they're not wrong, but they're missing the powerful signal underneath that noise. They're missing the idea that Bitcoin's future value isn't just a guess. It's programmed into its very design. The problem is the constant flood of conflicting information. One day, an analyst is calling for a crash to zero. The next, another expert predicts a surge to $1 million. This endless cycle of hype and fear leaves most people confused, anxious, and paralyzed, scared of missing out, but just as scared of getting burned. Today, we cut through that confusion. We're going to show you how understanding just two core pillars programmed into Bitcoin from day one can give you a clarity that few people have. We'll explore the mathematical certainty of its supply and the steady growth of its real-world use. Once you see how these two pieces fit together, you'll understand why Bitcoin's long-term path may already be locked in. Let's be honest, following the Bitcoin market day-to-day can feel like an absolute roller coaster. The price swings are legendary. A 20% drop in a single week? That's just a Tuesday in the crypto world. A 50% rally in a month? Also completely normal. This volatility is the biggest hurdle for most people. It creates a powerful anxiety, that nagging feeling that you're either buying at the very top or selling at the very bottom. So what's fueling this chaos? It's what you could call market noise. It's the endless stream of news headlines, social media chatter, and speculative excitement. Studies have shown that in the short term, Bitcoin's price is heavily influenced by social hype and online search trends. When the media is euphoric, people rush to buy, driven by a fear of missing out. When the mood turns sour, panic selling takes over. Much of this short-term frenzy is driven by what economists call the greater fool theory. This is the idea that you can buy an overvalued asset, hoping that an even greater fool will come along and buy it from you for more. In this game, fundamentals don't matter. Intrinsic value doesn't matter. The only thing that matters is psychology and momentum. This is what creates the explosive bubbles and devastating crashes that have come to define Bitcoin's public image. This environment has spawned an entire industry of experts who are more than happy to sell you their predictions. They draw lines on charts, analyze obscure indicators, and make bold proclamations with total confidence. But the truth is, no one can consistently predict these short-term swings. The market is a complex, chaotic dance of millions of people all acting on their own information and emotions. This is the pain point for anyone thinking about investing in Bitcoin. You're caught between the long-term promise of a revolutionary technology and the short-term reality of gut-wrenching volatility. It feels like you're trying to find a clear signal inside a hurricane of noise. But what if the noise isn't the real story? What if the daily, weekly, and even monthly price moves are just a distraction from a much more powerful underlying force? What if beneath all that chaos, there's a simple and predictable machine at work? A machine built not on hype or speculation, but on the cold, hard logic of math and code. To understand Bitcoin's future, we have to learn to ignore the noise and focus on the machine itself. We have to look past the frantic trading and into the unchangeable rules of the protocol. Because it's in these rules, in the very code that makes Bitcoin work, that we find the two pillars programming its destiny: absolute scarcity and growing utility. Let's start with the first and arguably the most important one. To really get why Bitcoin is unlike any other asset in history, you have to understand the concept of absolute scarcity. Not just regular scarcity, like gold or diamonds, but absolute scarcity. In economics, scarcity is what creates value. If something is infinitely available, it can't be valuable. What makes gold valuable? It's rare and it's hard to mine. But even with gold, we don't know for sure how much is out there. A new discovery or a new mining technology could, in theory, increase the supply. Its scarcity is high, but it's not absolute. This is where Bitcoin changes the game. In 2008, the anonymous creator Satoshi Nakamoto published the Bitcoin white paper and made a critical design choice. The total supply of Bitcoin would be capped at 21 million, not 21 million and one, just 21 million forever. This wasn't an accident, it was a master stroke. Satoshi knew that to create a true global store of value, a kind of digital gold, it had to have a supply that couldn't be manipulated, Unlike government currencies like the US dollar, which central banks can print at will, no one can create more Bitcoin. Not a government, not a bank, not even Satoshi. The 21 million limit is enforced by a global network of computers, and changing it would require a consensus so broad it's considered practically impossible. This gives Bitcoin a property no other asset has ever had, a predictable, transparent, and finite supply. We know exactly how many Bitcoin exist today and how many will be created tomorrow, thanks to a mechanism at the heart of its code, the halving. The halving is a simple but profound piece of engineering. Miners use their computers to verify transactions and secure the network. And as a reward, they receive new bitcoins. Satoshi programmed the code so that approximately every 4 years, this reward gets cut in half. When Bitcoin started in 2009, the reward was 50 Bitcoin per block. In 2012, it dropped to 25 BTC. In 2016, it halved to 12.5 BTC. In 2020, it halved again to 6.25 BTC. And most recently, in April 2024, the reward was cut to just 3.125 BTC per block. Each halving is a supply shock, dramatically slowing down the creation of new Bitcoin. Imagine a gold mine where every 4 years, the miners suddenly find their equipment can only pull half as much gold out of the ground. This creates a perfectly predictable supply schedule. We can chart it out, and it shows a curve that gets flatter and flatter as it approaches the 21 million cap. As of late 2025, around 19.7 million BTC have already been mined. The last fraction of a Bitcoin will be mined around the year 2140. This means Bitcoin's inflation rate is also pre-programmed and always decreasing. Right now, after the 2024 halving, Bitcoin's annual inflation rate is under 1%. Compare that to the 2-3% target for most central banks. Bitcoin is already one of the hardest forms of money on the planet, and it's mathematically guaranteed to get harder every 4 years. This predictable scarcity led to a famous valuation model, the stock-to-flow model. Popularized by the analyst Plan B, the model quantifies scarcity by comparing an asset's total existing supply, the stock, to its new annual production, the flow. The higher the ratio, the scarcer the asset. For centuries, gold had the highest S2F ratio, but after the 2024 halving, Bitcoin's S2F ratio is now in the same league, with some estimates showing it has surpassed gold's. The model plots this increasing scarcity against Bitcoin's price and finds a strong correlation, suggesting that as scarcity increases, the price rises in a predictable way. Now, it's important to be clear. All models are wrong, but some are useful. The S2F model has its critics, and it's not a crystal ball. It focuses on the supply side and has deviated from the actual price at times. Some argue its predictive power is waning as the market matures. Still, its core insight is powerful. It shows the profound economic impact of Bitcoin's programmed scarcity. Whether the price hits a specific target or not, the principle holds. An asset with a verifiably finite and shrinking supply has a powerful, built-in mechanism for its value to grow. This is the first pillar. It's not a story or a feeling, it's math. Bitcoin is the first asset in history with absolute verifiable scarcity. But scarcity alone isn't enough. For scarcity to create value, it needs the second pillar, demand, which comes from utility. If you're starting to see how Bitcoin's code builds a foundation for its value, do me a favor and hit that subscribe button and turn on notifications. You won't want to miss the second half of this equation. An asset can be the scarcest thing in the universe, but if nobody wants it, it's worthless. The reason Bitcoin's absolute scarcity is so important is because it's paired with a second powerful force, expanding utility. Demand for Bitcoin isn't just speculation. It's growing from several fundamental sources that are getting stronger every day. Let's break down the three main drivers of Bitcoin's utility. First, and most importantly, Bitcoin is a decentralized store of value. This is the digital gold idea, and it's the most powerful use case today. What does that really mean? It means Bitcoin lets you store your wealth in a way that can't be easily confiscated, censored, or devalued. Think about the money in your bank account. It isn't truly yours. The bank holds it for you, and they can freeze your account. A government can seize your funds, or more quietly, they can devalue your savings by printing more money. With Bitcoin, if you hold your own private keys, you have absolute control. This is called self-custody. No one can stop you from sending it, and no one can take it from you. This is financial sovereignty, and that's becoming more and more valuable in a world of growing economic uncertainty. This idea has been supercharged by the actions of central banks. As governments expand money supplies and take on huge debt, people are looking for an escape hatch to protect their purchasing power from inflation. For instance, predictions in late 2025 suggested the Federal Reserve would soon begin cutting interest rates again, signaling more monetary easing, a policy that is fundamentally bullish for a hard asset like Bitcoin. This idea is no longer on the fringe. Even the CEO of BlackRock, Larry Fink, who once dismissed Bitcoin, now endorses it as a hedge against currency devaluation, a huge shift from the heart of traditional finance. The second driver of utility is Bitcoin's role as a global settlement network. Critics often say Bitcoin's base layer is too slow for buying coffee, but that misses the big picture. The main network is built for security and finality, like a global vault for settling large, important transactions. The real magic for everyday payments is happening on layer 2 solutions built on top of Bitcoin, especially the Lightning Network. The Lightning Network is a protocol that allows for nearly instant, almost free Bitcoin transactions. It's the technology that makes Bitcoin a viable medium of exchange. And its growth has been explosive. Once a niche experiment, the Lightning Network has seen its capacity and usage soar. Major exchanges like Coinbase and Kraken and payment apps like Cash App have all integrated Lightning, bringing it to hundreds of millions of users. It's being used in the real world, from online marketplaces in Japan to supermarkets in South Africa. The fees generated from routing payments, while typically low, are a clear sign of real, sustainable economic activity. The Lightning Network is quietly turning Bitcoin from just digital gold into a true global payment system for the internet age. The third and maybe most explosive pillar of utility is the recent flood of institutional adoption. For its first decade, Bitcoin was mostly a retail game. That has completely changed. The launch of spot Bitcoin ETFs in the US in early 2024 was the watershed moment, the crack in the dam that turned into a flood of institutional money. These ETFs gave the world's biggest financial players a regulated and easy way to get exposure to Bitcoin, and they've been a massive success. BlackRock's iShares Bitcoin Trust, IBIT, became one of the most successful ETF launches in history, accumulating over $70 billion in assets under management in its first year. By late 2025, U.S. spot Bitcoin ETFs collectively held over 1.3 million BTC, soaking up a significant portion of the circulating supply. This isn't just passive investing. The very institutions Bitcoin was designed to bypass are now integrating it. JP Morgan, whose CEO once called Bitcoin a fraud, now reportedly accepts it as collateral for loans. We're seeing major corporations add Bitcoin to their balance sheets. And a 2025 survey from EY and Coinbase found that a staggering 86% of global institutional investors either have or plan to get exposure to digital assets. So what does this all mean? We have multiple powerful sources of demand all growing at the same time. Individual demand from people seeking a hedge against inflation. Technological demand from the Lightning Network making Bitcoin usable for payments. And now, massive institutional demand from the world's biggest financial players. Scarcity without demand is worthless, but what we have with Bitcoin is absolute scarcity, meeting a tidal wave of expanding utility. When those two forces meet, something remarkable happens. This is where we connect the dots. We have Bitcoin's two fundamental pillars, a perfectly predictable, finite supply, and a diverse, rapidly growing demand. Let's put them together to see how they create a predictable long-term price path. Think back to the first supply and demand graph you ever saw in economics class. You have price on one axis and quantity on the other. The price is found where the supply and demand lines cross. Now, let's apply this to Bitcoin. For almost any other asset, the supply curve slopes up. If the price of oil goes up, producers drill for more. Bitcoin breaks this model. The new supply of Bitcoin is what economists call perfectly inelastic. It doesn't respond to price. It doesn't matter if Bitcoin's price is $1 or $1 million. The number of new Bitcoins created is determined only by the unchangeable halving schedule. For all practical purposes, its new supply curve is a vertical line on a path to a hard cap of 21 million. Now let's look at the demand curve. As we just covered, demand for Bitcoin is growing from multiple powerful directions. More individuals are buying it as a store of value. The Lightning Network is increasing its use for payments. A wave of institutional capital has just started to enter the market. On our graph, this means the demand curve is constantly shifting to the right. More people want to buy Bitcoin at every price. So what happens when you have a perfectly fixed supply and a demand curve that is constantly moving out? The only variable left to adjust is the price. The intersection point of the two curves can only move in one direction over the long term, up. This is what we mean when we say Bitcoin's future price is programmed. It's not about predicting a specific price on a specific date. It's about understanding the fundamental economic machine at the heart of the protocol. It is a machine designed to turn growing adoption into a higher price. The combination of a digitally enforced shrinking supply and expanding global demand creates a powerful one-way pressure on its value over long periods. It's not magic, it's just economics. This also helps explain how Bitcoin's market cycles are evolving. For years, the market moved in a fairly predictable four-year cycle, driven almost entirely by the supply shock of the halving. But things are changing. After the 2024 halving, we saw months of consolidation instead of an immediate rally, leading some to believe the old cycle is fading. This isn't a sign of weakness, it's a sign of maturity. As institutional capital and global economic trends become bigger drivers, the market is no longer solely dependent on the halving. The cycles may be getting longer, and the volatility may gradually decrease. The halving is shifting from being the primary catalyst to being a constant underlying tightening pressure. The engine is moving from being purely supply-driven to being a powerful dance between an ever-constricting supply and an ever-expanding demand. This makes the long-term case even stronger, as the value is now anchored by two robust, growing foundations. So, when we zoom out, the picture becomes clear. For over a decade, the world has been captivated and confused by Bitcoin's wild price swings. The media has often painted it as a speculative frenzy with no real value. But this view mistakes the noise for the signal. When you look past the daily volatility and at the core design of the network, you see something different. Bitcoin's long-term value isn't based on hype. It's anchored by two powerful pillars written directly into its code. Pillar one is absolute scarcity, a supply capped forever at 21 million coins, with a creation schedule that is perfectly predictable, making it the hardest asset humanity has ever known. Pillar two is expanding utility, a demand that is growing relentlessly from individuals seeking financial freedom, from technology enabling global payments, and from the world's largest financial institutions finally treating Bitcoin as a legitimate asset. The long-term price of Bitcoin is simply the result of these two forces colliding. An unyielding fixed supply meeting a wave of growing global demand. This is the simple, elegant machine at the heart of Bitcoin. It's a machine programmed for long-term appreciation. Of course, this isn't financial advice. The short-term will always be volatile, and global events can cause massive price swings. There will be periods of fear and doubt, but through all that chaos, the underlying code doesn't change. The 21 million cap remains. The halvings continue, and the global adoption of this technology marches forward. The real shift is to stop seeing Bitcoin as just a speculative bet and to start seeing it as a technological revolution with a predictable long-term direction. The story of Bitcoin is still in its early chapters. As these two coded pillars of scarcity and utility continue to play out, the question is no longer if Bitcoin will be valuable, but how valuable it will become. Now, I want to hear from you. What do you think is the biggest driver of Bitcoin's utility in the next 5 years? Is it the Lightning Network, institutional ETFs, or its role as a store of value in an inflationary world? Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. And if you want a deeper dive into how the Bitcoin halving works, check out this video right here. Thanks for watching.